Cool. Welcome to Bring Your A Game, Leveling Up Class Discussion. So I just did this introduction of myself to my students yesterday. So I always go by, because this is an important first day discussion, how do you want to be called? Like, what do you want to be called? What's okay or acceptable from your students? I say I don't like hey you and hey miss, but some form of like Dr. Professor, Traci, Dr. Traci, Dr. T, Dr. B, any of that is frankly fine with me, but my preferred term is coach. I've never coached a single sports ball event, but that I think it is a really good way to talk about what I do in the classroom, which is that I know the game, I know the plays, I set up some really rad things to do and go like, go, 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 go from the sides and then tell you what to do, which is not fight KU at the end of the game. But that it's a really good metaphor for also what we're doing in class. And that way they didn't even have to remember my name. They could just say coach whenever they were at a loss. But that's what we're doing. I've got some ideas. I've got some plays for us to run, but you're the one doing the work. You're the one who's got to have the hustle. You're the one, you know, like making the knowledge, making the art in the room. So that's what I like to be called, but it's also something that's an extension of my personality. I make really bad sports puns the entire class, and they're very aware that I know nothing about sports, although I did just have a really excellent KU, KSU basketball reference. That is it for my sports knowledge. But for me, it's an extension of who I am, and so then that really lets them know something about me from the very first day, as well as something about my classroom and how I run it. So now I want to know, I'm going to give you a couple of tips about also how I learn a room full of names, because foolishly one time I just like wrote down what people were wearing, which is a really terrible idea that is not thought through at all. I even told one class I was writing down what shoes they were wearing, and they're like, everybody change shoes for the next class. So that one didn't help. But I do note backpacks and shoe color, because then in future classes, I say, it's not that I don't want to look them in the eye, but then it's a really quick reference, flower backpack, okay, hello, Sarah. And then that just works really fast as a way to start recognizing your students much quicker if you don't have very good facial recognition, and not everybody does. So those are a couple of my pro tips, as well as what I'm going to do with you, which is draw out a little diagram of the room and then note your names when you say them, so that hopefully as we keep going, I can learn a few names even in the course of just this quick afternoon talking about games. But I'm calling this Bringing Your A Game, Leveling Up Class Discussion through the playing of games and ways to bring elements of games into your classroom to increase student investment in the conversation and make sure everybody stays engaged. But I just want to hear your names and a game that you love. This can be a board game you played as a child. If you were one of those children who might have liked Monopoly, that would be fascinating to learn. Or if there's a game now, if you have a game night and you love the game Telestrations or Cards Against Humanity, just to hear a game that you currently play, used to play, a game maybe that you like. And hopefully that will get us around the two loops of the room fairly quickly, and I can get to know your names pretty quick. How do you feel about starting? Perfect. Oh, excellent. Thank you.
Old Wives Tales.
Ooh, I'm going to have to ask you about that game in the future, Rebecca. I don't know that one.
Probably just to make sure that our Zoom audience
Okay.
If you have any, you want to say, please use the mic. Just
thanks, Tucker. Sorry.
Victor, Oregon Trail.
Oregon Trail.
Kathleen, Uno.
Scott, Settlers of Catan.
Jamila, Uno as well.
Elena, what do you meme?
David, psychiatrist.
Sarah, telephone Pictionary.
Taylor, anything on Wii.
Renee, Settlers of Catan.
Melissa, Mario Kart.
Roberta, and I like that meme game too.
Mitzi and Farm Heroes.
Krishna Gimire.
And then if we could just start the other side of the rainbow, yeah. Oh, sorry.
Pratibha, tic-tac-toe.
Wendy, mahjong.
Devin, chess.
Ashley, pinochle.
Patricia, checkers.
Ken, Yahtzee.
Mandy, trekking national parks.
Sipasi, soccer.
Kim, balderdash.
Angela, code names.
Tiffany, elder sign.
Stuart, pool.
Andy, cows on my side.
Catherine, clue.
Laura, spades.
Tucker, euchre. And then on, we have Carrie in phase 10. And Myrta, what do you mean?
So thinking about, there's some games in here also that I don't know what they are. And that also kind of excites me. Because I also wouldn't say I'm a huge game person. I'm sort of a bummer on anything with a team game because I get really competitive and then disappointed in my own competitiveness. And then I get flustered and it doesn't go very well. But I play a lot of Uno with my kid. We play this great game called Sleeping Queens. And I think there are tons of ways people get very invested in games. They love to do this. Anybody who's played a Jeopardy for review has noticed that their student engagement on that day totally goes up. I also want to say before I begin that you don't have to take all of these ideas. These are ideas that I've used in classes that have worked for me, but they aren't going to work for every style class or every subject matter. I've tried to identify each game, when it's a good time to use that one, the rules that you would play by, and why it's beneficial to use that game. And it's just a way to sort of take normal discussion tactics, because you often say, you know, well, what do you think? And then you have to wait. So that is my great weakness. I should lead with my strength, but I'll tell you straight up, one of the things I am worst at as a teacher is being patient and waiting for my students to contribute. I love to talk, and I'm a great monologuer. I can monologue my syllabus on day one like nobody's business, but no one needs to see me perform a syllabus. They need to know what's on it, right? And I really struggle to wait to let people think through things, to let them come up with their own answers. And the game we're gonna play at the very end is one that my students gave me, right? So there are times when giving them an opportunity, they showed up with an idea and an activity that engaged all of us, that kept everybody talking, and that gave me another, you know, another arrow in my pedagogical quiver. So one of the great things about games is lots of people have a sort of innate competitiveness or a love of games. And usually when you do these activities, they're things that ensure that everybody contributes. When you're playing musical chairs, people can't be on their phones, can they? So it increases the level of their own investment. Everybody engages. And for me, this plays on one of my strengths, which is also perhaps a weakness. It's that my teaching persona just is my personality, for better or worse. And that's a fairly goofy person who's fairly casual. And so this is a way where sort of my personality blends well with this pedagogical style. It might not be for you, but hopefully there's at least one of the six ideas or something in the game that you already said that you loved that ends up being something you can pull back into your classroom. Okay, so the first one I stuck with, the most boring one, which is Jeopardy. It's not a boring game, it's a great game, I know. But this is one that people are more familiar with, right? If you've got to do a comprehensive review around midterms or before an exam, you can create all these different categories. So you put your groups into teams. Because I don't have a classroom this nice, we come up with taking turns, right? Because we don't have buzzers or fancy technology. We're just going to take turns and I'm going to pick a piece of paper off the board. But there are also really great websites where you could fill in all of this information and have it ready in a nice technology classroom. But then you also have these categories. One of the great things about those categories is it's signaling what are the major ideas that are important in your class, big themes or overarching concepts that you've been covering that you want to make sure they're prepared to talk about. And then when you scale up those point amounts, you're doing the exact same thing you would do on like an exam or even that you're structuring with your syllabus, where the lower stakes things are worth smaller amounts and the more complex integrated thinking happens later. Also, pro tip. real clear rules about what stealing is, right? Because some ways that games are played with cards or on TV are going to be different than you can play them in class. So things like what it takes to steal a point category in Jeopardy, make sure everybody knows what the rules are ahead of time so that people aren't shouting out and going over each other, because also keeping it a productive like review session and learning environment is making sure everybody knows what the rules are. So again, I already mentioned one of the ways that everybody wins is you're doing this complex order thinking and starting with lower things and building up. You're making clear what categories are important. You're putting up questions that are similar to things you might put on an exam and having them group think and talk through. I always let my Jeopardy groups, you don't have to know, buzz in, right? We're taking turns. They get a chance to discuss and be like, do you remember that? No, it was the day that we talked about. Okay, yeah, that's it. We got it. It's ants, whatever it is. But that gives them a chance to like group think, to talk it through, to work out a problem. And as the point systems go up, they get more time because I'm often asking things where they do have to check in and answer a more complex question. And just with Jeopardy, people just do get really invested or engaged. And especially with stealing being possible, right? You can't tune out just because another group is answering. You have to be ready with your answer. So it keeps everybody paying attention the entire time. And with that no teacher wait time, either I have a timer set for that exact amount of the question, but I'm not just standing there like, so what do you think? Who remembers the day I talked about ants? Like none of that happens, right? I don't just have to stand there in that horrible dead silence. They're asking each other, they're checking in, they're coming up with an answer, and then they're raising their hand, and they really want to give me the answer versus otherwise just like, oh my God, please, I just want to text my friend back about Taco Tuesday. But so they're all paying attention. I'm not standing there like trying to count on, it's fine, they're gonna answer. They're gonna raise a hand eventually. But people are pretty familiar with Jeopardy. But another great one is bingo. So this is really good if you have a lot of terms in history. So you start, but you've gotta have different bingo sheets, right? Just like if you're running a bingo hall, you cannot let everybody have the same sheet. So it does take some work to like cut and paste and like move your categories around different places. Also, I often call it something story in a storytelling class, or I pick five letters that aren't bingo. But bingo works. Bingo's great. Bingo's classic. So you give students, you take one of those bingo sheets and you cut it up and you go around and they have to take a couple of terms out of the hat. In some quiet time ahead of time, they're Googling those terms, right? You're introducing new vocabulary, or you're talking about something that you need a lot of historical terms to understand, because they don't know who Nixon was, and you're trying to teach them Watchmen. They don't know, they have no idea. So they're doing that research, they're looking things up. So then as you start playing the game, you call out the terms and say like, okay, who has Nixon? People are like, okay, so turns out this guy was president, and they start telling everybody else the research they've just done. And then you say, okay, if you have Nixon in B or G, you may exit out. And they've all got different categories. So they're listening, they're paying attention as their peers teach them the research terms that they need for this for going forward with what you're learning. And they're paying attention, they're listening. Everybody's staying really engaged because they have to keep track of what they're being taught and if they can mark it out. I usually also give them just the terms on the side, so then they can write in those definitions as their peers are teaching them. So one, as much as I enjoy a good lecture because the monologuing skills are strong with me, it makes them in charge of learning, of like, you need to find an answer to something, go look it up. Your first source didn't work out, keep looking. So it makes them in charge of doing some of that research learning and bringing it to the table. Then they're also, because they have to repackage that learning, they have to tell everybody in the room what they learned when they looked up the poem Ozymandias, they're having to rephrase the knowledge that they think they've just acquired, right? So by reteaching the class the term that they've just looked up, they're figuring out how to reword it, how to explain what it is that they know. So it's making them like try and figure it out, try and assess sources. You get on the spot assessment from what they're doing. And you can say like, oh yes, that's great. Okay, another thing you need to know for the purpose of the short story we're gonna read next is that actually in 1946, right? So then you can fill in any gaps that you are aware that they are all prepared with the same level. They're doing the work, they're doing the search, they're trying to, you know, help out and contribute. And then you're just making sure everybody has the same information going forward. So then for prizes, you can have some candy bars and some Cheez-Its in there. Sometimes I have extra credit points. Sometimes I ask them what they would like if they win. This is why this sweet animal is here with me today. This was our class mascot. They said they wanted a class pet as a prize. And we decided passing around a betta fish from apartment to apartment was probably pretty traumatizing to a little fish. So we decided a stuffed animal would be the prize. The team winners took it home first, taking turns, and they would send me pictures of what, it's a reindeer, but I didn't realize that, so it's moose. And they'd send me pictures of what moose was up to, and we would always start class with pictures of what moose did on his last outing. So it created a sense of community in class, and they're the ones who gave me this idea. I didn't have this idea. Created a sense of community in class, then our class pet went on different adventures. We got these pictures into each other's lives, and this is one of the ideas that they gave me for community building in my class. I wouldn't have come up with that. Pictionary. This one's a fun one. We all know how to do this. This is a great one if it's a review of vocabulary terms, especially if there's a way to make it visual. So people may know Pictionary, but ideally, right, you put them in their teams. You make sure also to prep them, not it's going to be something from class, right? But we're reviewing, you know, elements of storytelling or, you know, moments from this period of history or something like that. So they know the category so they can at least feel somewhat prepared for engaging. They pick up the concept and then the responsible in a timed amount to draw that concept on the board. One of the reasons that's such an interesting way to review some vocabulary is also you have to think about that concept. In my case, if I'm talking about point of view in storytelling, how do you draw a point of view? So what is that student taking this definition that they know and they're turning it into an image? So by taking something that they think they know or a term, some sort of definition, and transforming it into another way to communicate, they're thinking through, well, how do you represent that? What does that mean? What does that look like? So they are having to ask themselves those questions, transform a bit of knowledge into something visual, and then by looking at it, can people guess what that is? And what are they recalling that information from things that we have said in class? It should just be said that for most of these games, you do get a high level of engagement. One of the ways you always win is that people stay engaged. They want to win games. They want to win that Snickers bar, the extra credit points, those sorts of things. So people just stay really invested in what you're doing. I'm getting to some of the more complicated rules ones, but the game Celebrity Heads. Has anybody played this game before? Okay, a few nods, a lot of head shaking. Okay, so this is the idea. Sometimes when you buy the kit, it comes with like a headband and you have the celebrity on front. Instead of having them wear headbands or putting a post-it on their forehead, I've been more comfortable and I always ask ahead of time, can I put a name on your back? And then I put names on people's backs. And so if you have if you're teaching a lot of historical figures, there's probably a way also in like a zoology class with lots of animals, you could probably figure out a way to do it. For me, teaching literature, characters, it can be a really good one. So then when they come up to a new person, so if we were playing, I would go up to Scott and Scott would turn around and show me his back and be like, okay, he's that character. And I'd be like, okay, here's who I am, Scott. Okay, and then Scott and I would have two yes or no questions to ask each other. But then after two, we'd have to move on because that person, what if that person didn't read that very well? You'd want to double check. I trust Scott to read. I'm sure Scott read the novel that we're talking about. But if not, right, you go on and you ask other people questions. The other thing I make them do is, in addition to the yes, no, they have to have it be true for more than one person. Because what that makes us start thinking about is, what do these people have in common? So when I teach my medical literature class, what do these people have in common? What's in common with these illnesses? What's in common with a symptom? What's in common with their relationship to their care provider? So they start thinking about what's similar or different. So they can't just say like, am I the one from the book in the 1970s? Doesn't work. You can't just guess one person. It's gotta be true of multiple people. So you have to use sort of these narrowing Venn diagrams of similarities and differences to sort of come to the right answer of who you might be. And the 1 to 2 questions is also just to get them to talking to other peers, right? They're standing up, they're moving around, they're engaging with other peers. Again, you can't be on your cell phone and playing Celebrity Heads with your classmates, right? You have to be engaged. You have to also be thinking through like, did that person have that relationship with their care provider? I feel like I can't say yes or no, right? Like you have to be thinking through all the texts that you've read, making those comparisons yourself as you're playing the game and making sure that you know that. So moving around, they have to think through those things. And it pairs also an element of solo and collaborative learning. Because at the end, I say like, okay, write down your guess. Now go to your book or your, you can open your laptop and find the text. Find a quote that you think best sums up the character that you were or the person from a memoir that you were today. And then we share those aloud in class. So then they're doing individual work and deeper thinking about a single character. Plus they've had sort of a review and had to remember all sorts of characters or historical figures or terms or animals in zoology, because they've had to do that compare contrast, sort of figuring things out, narrowing down. So then they get both some of that teamwork and some of that solo work combined in this activity. Okay, this one's the most complicated. And I myself don't even like the title. Oh wait, nope, we got musical chairs first, my bad. If you have somebody with mobility issues, you absolutely cannot play musical chairs. But with one student who had a broken leg, I said, you know, you pick the category you wanna answer. And so she just hung out, she's like, I'm gonna answer that one. But musical chairs only works in certain mobile classrooms where you can move chairs around. And also, right, if somebody has mobility issues, musical chairs is not the game. But if you do, you set up your number of chairs, just like old school musical chairs, and you have to ask subjective questions. This is one of those, like, which one is the most moral character in the book? It's one of my favorite questions to ask. You start the music, everybody walks around, everybody has to think of an answer. They can't answer that text about Taco Tuesday. They have to be thinking about an answer, because when the music stops, if they're not in a chair, they have to tell you who is they think, because it's subjective. This isn't a way to call somebody out or make them feel bad. They just get to say, like, you know, I totally think it's Rorschach because he really does follow his principles, or okay, like, I think it's Dr. Manhattan because people really are terrible, or whatever it is. They get to decide, right? They get to reveal something about themselves in the answer, and it's subjective, so it's not outing anybody for, like, not knowing a right answer, but it has to be something opinion-based, subjective, where anybody could answer. But what it just guarantees that everybody has to think of an answer, right? They can't zone out, they can't be thinking about what to do in the next class. Everybody's thinking about an answer because when the music stops, if they're left standing, they know they have to answer. Again, teaching early morning classes, it gets people up and moving. And for me, right, it enforces that teacher wait time. I have to wait those few seconds because I am playing Michael Jackson's Thriller and I have to find a good moment to stop it. There's no good moment to stop it. But it makes sure that I am quiet for a minute and they're sitting there thinking and they have the time to think while also moving and like kind of giggling and like playing a silly game in a college classroom that they were not expecting in their college experience. So for me, it's not great all the time, but on occasion, this is a nice one to throw in to start the class up and moving early in the morning when people are very tired and thinking through again, something subjective. They are not being punished for not knowing. They aren't being called out. And when I have had students that I know have social anxiety, I just check in ahead of time so that they know what the activity is and to make sure that they feel comfortable participating. Everyone's always said yes, but I always check. All right. And now for the horrible name and the horrible game, Cards Against the Humanities. They aren't actually anti-humanities questions. They're very deeply humanities questions because they're all about critical thinking. But it just plays on the name of the popular game, Cards Against Humanity. Usually my students are familiar with that game. If you are not, I'm gonna try and explain these rules very slowly, but usually they're familiar and they're like, oh yeah, we got this. But this is all this is a way to make a game out of small groups, critical thinking discussions. So I actually set my students up into teams in the very beginning of a semester. I give them like a sorting hat type of quiz where they fill out like, I think I'm a leader, I think I'm a listener, which Ninja Turtle are you, which whatever are you, and then that helps me sort of figure out how to create some sort of balanced teams among the class. And so when they get into groups, they usually know the groups that they're gonna be in anyway. I'm going with four groups to sort of help make some of the rules that I'm explaining make sense as I go, because I like four groups. Four groups of four or five, depending on the size of your class. If you have large lecture halls, I recognize this doesn't work so well. But then I just have four questions already up on the board. Sometimes I'm working with four different themes or four different ideas that we've been talking about before. And then they already have all four of those questions. Then to each small group, I would go over to one group and I would give you like black card number one and three white cards, and you would have black card number two and three white cards, and you would get black card number three and four white cards, and you'd get black card number four and three white cards. So if you have question number four, that means you don't answer number four. You answer questions one, two, and three. Same thing with black card number three, that means you answer one, two, and four, and so on. With two, you answer one, three, four. So because you have the black card, it means you become the judging panel for everybody else's questions. So on those white note cards, you're answering those other three questions, you're talking about it, you're thinking through what is the best answer to this question, and then I collect everybody's lovely anonymous answers and then give them back. To card one gets the other three groups' answer to one. Group two gets the other three answers to question two. Three would have those other anonymous responses, and then four gets the batch of four. So now you've done all this critical thinking, answering three questions, and now you sit in the panel of critical thinking judges of like which of your peers' answers is the best critical thinking response to that question that you're judging on. So like then you start evaluating like, well, what makes a good response of like, how is this, or like what unique point did they have, or they all kind of said the same thing, but this person said it the best. Even if the idea is the same, this person like phrased it the best. And then much like Cards Against Humanity, the group that wins, then you give them the black cards. I do several rounds of this, and then the team with the most black cards wins. Again, this is just critical thinking, but if you're like, hey, here's a handout with a list of questions, then it's like, oh yeah, this, or like, oh my gosh, what are you doing? Like, have you finished that assignment in anthropology? And they did what they were supposed to do, but the level of investment, right? If there's something to be won, there's just a little bit more investment. When they start assessing, that also puts the onus on them to figure out what does make a good critical thinking answer, not, oh, teacher's so mean, she gave the prize to so-and-so because whatever. They're the ones deciding which among their peers is doing the best job answering things. So I know those rules are a little bit more complicated, but hopefully like the general idea kind of makes sense, that in these small groups discussions, giving them a reason to invest in their critical thinking and a way to win something. Again, sometimes it's a couple of extra credit points. And when you've got like 1,000 points to give out, like two extra credit points is nothing, and yet they're in it to win it more than those papers that they're turning in, or those quizzes they're showing up for. Somehow you call it extra credit, and they're ready to win those points. The other thing I point out with this and with almost everything that I do is that these questions, and then I go back like, hey, remember that slide from the beginning when we talked about the paper questions coming up? These are just different ways to ask that question, or just ways to keep you digging there. Everything that I asked for in these small groups discussions helps you write the paper. The paper becomes your study guide for the exam. So like, I definitely point out how intentional everything it is that we are doing is. So like, if you find a good quote for this, that can go into your paper. I'm like, can't they see how brilliantly I've designed it all? Don't they know that this is just a version of that? But if you just point out, like, here's why you should care, right? Like, if you do a good job on this activity today, you've already got like a great quote and a great idea or a thesis argument for your upcoming paper. So pointing out how all these things benefit them, and just being really explicit for these are strategies for success. So I'm trying to make it fun to also be doing all the work that I'm trying to just be getting them to do by being a very exuberant person at the front of the room. But I can do as many jumping jacks as I want, but giving them two extra credit points will make them care so much more. And making something a game just gets a much higher level of investment from the people in the room, which I like to see. I like it when their energy almost overwhelms mine. That's a good day in class for me. So I thought up other games that students have brought, because I do make them in charge sometimes of like, okay, you're responsible for coming up with how are we gonna review this this time. So Kahoot, people are probably really familiar with Kahoot, but this again is a lovely way, and that's one of my rules for them, is they cannot call anyone out or make anyone feel uncomfortable in the review game that we play. Kahoot is a great way to do that, to make it anonymous. They've come up with Family Feud in your various Family Feud teams for like review and checking in. Hot Potato is the one we're actually going to play here after I check my time and see how I'm doing. But Hot Potato is a great one, just if you're stuck holding the thing at the end, you're the one who has to answer. I have done scavenger hunts. I actually did a syllabus scavenger hunt yesterday with my students, where they had a sheet, and I was like, hi, this is who I am. Go find this information in the syllabus. And then they had to pair up and see if they had all the answers, because I'm convinced that if they have looked for it, and if they have articulated to somebody else what these policies are, and then we check in at the end and just say like, yeah. Okay, so another thing, the reason why I say that is this. This is my rationale for why this is on the syllabus, right? So like, I'm still reviewing it with them, but they have done the work to look, they become familiar with, I was like, okay, what page is that in the syllabus is that on? Well, page 5. I was like, thank you. They've already written down the answer, so they know. So that if they forget by the time we're on week 11 and they need that information, they know where to go back and check if they've remembered day one. But I've done scavenger hunts for other kinds of information. I've also done things like mock trials and mock talk shows to like get them of like people who are extrovertedly inclined, and we always need an audience, so we don't need them all to do that part. But they find it a lot, they're a lot more engaged if their peers are up there pretending to be characters that we have read and ways in which they are preparing. And I was like, okay, prepare, like quiz them on who they are as a character, what's their motivation? And then they get up and we have these questions and unpack some of these larger themes and issues going on in something that we're reading. So I think also, gosh, some of these, I don't know how, because some of these are more involved games, right? Like, so some of the games that we talked about take a long time to set up and to play. But also things that I have done, like when I played superheroes in American literature, everybody went by a superhero name and they had a superhero stat card with me, and I called them their superhero name in class. And I would give them strength points and agility points and healing points based on their how they did in games. You guys, it was worth nothing. Like, it was literally nothing. They're like, oh, yeah. And they wanted to like level up their character in class. And they really didn't get anything from this other than at the end, I gave them a graduation from superhero school and said they became like an alpha level superhero or a beta level superhero or whatever based on their point accumulation. It's nothing, right? Like, it wasn't even extra credit. It wasn't a candy bar. They were just leveling up their character in class, but they were invested to earn those points for their character cards in class. So it doesn't even have to be if you're just like, I'm against extra credit. There are also ways to tie something into what you're doing there in class or a team identity. Because I also, with my teams that I set up in class, they choose a team name. So like a group that all wanted to be OBs called themselves Team Tiny Humans, or, you know, people just come up with their own team identity name. And then teams can also build points. So there's a variety of ways that you could adapt this to your subject matter and getting your students to invest in like a group identity or their some other thing in class that gets them attached to a small community in class or the classroom community as a whole if you have a smaller classroom size where they could do that. Okay, so I wanted to do a few pro tips before we play hot potato. So one of the things is making sure the rules are very clear and read aloud. This is something I've noticed, especially when I have the students lead the activity, is they'll be like, well, we're gonna play Jeopardy. So you, you're a team, and you guys are a team, and okay, here we go. So unless rules are very clear, then people will be like, but that's not how we played it last time, or that's not how we do it in the other class. Or, that Alex Trebek would be so mad at you. So whatever it is, just make sure everybody knows the rules you're playing by, that it's very clear. Today I'm not gonna be prepared with it, but usually I have the everything on a slide as well as I verbally articulate it, but just to make sure everybody's on the same board. But with that, repeat the game, right? So like when I repeat an activity, I do something to make it harder. I do something to have it like level up, and we're adding some new element to it this time. So this time we're gonna take what we did before and we're gonna add this piece to it, because they're already familiar with the rules of Cards Against the Humanities from before. Here's how we're gonna make it harder. So the first time I gave them prompt questions, now they're just getting a theme word and they write the question, and then we, you know, go from there. So I find ways to, they're familiar with those rules of the game. So how are you gonna up the level of engagement or give them an additional challenge as they keep going through the course of the class? Make sure why your students know they're playing that game. Like again, I point out, this is just a different version of the paper question. Most of the time, they'll just be happy they're doing something active or playing a game. They'll think that's pretty cool. But some people will be like, why the hell is our teacher making us play musical chairs? Or whatever it is. And you can just be really clear about why we're doing what we're doing. I try and make this very clear on the assignments. Every assignment has a but why page. It's like, here's what you're getting out. Remember this learning objective. Remember we were talking about this before. This is gonna connect to that and build. And here's where we're gonna be taking it, you know, in a few weeks. So I just try and like be really explicit about there's a real function to why we're making this a game or why we're playing this game in particular or what you're getting out of this activity. So that if there was some hesitation, people can be like, okay, games aren't my thing, but I want to write a good paper or whatever it is. So they see what they're getting out of it as well. I'd also say that when I got some game ideas early on in teaching, somebody said, you really just have to play one or two games in your class. And that when you get T-bells, people will be like, this was such a fun class. And you're like, I played two games that took 5 minutes each. But just it stuck in their minds. It's something that people remember. Because this is another thing that guides my pedagogy, which is I often think about the whole university as my classroom and try and create experiences around assignments to make them go out and do something that they're bringing back to, in one class, they have to go interview their mother about her birth experience of them, and they have to turn it into a movie trailer. But what's making them take something about their experience in class and ideas that were concepts we're talking about there and taking it somewhere out into the world? Whether it's like teaching them something about their families, listening to something on campus, going to do the cool tree walk with the QR codes around campus. We've played with the Legos and Weigel. But finding things that connect experience to the learning, because I know that at the end of their 4 years, and maybe even beyond, they will not remember my really amazing lecture on the Oxford comma, but they will remember the experiences they had in class. It's experiences and how what they sort of learned from that that's going to stick with them. And so those are the things I'm trying to attach a lot of learning to experience and activity that helps them recall things. So that's another reason that that's part of my pedagogy and something that I care about doing in a classroom. So do you want to play hot potato first or do you want to ask me questions first? And now I'm going to do the teacher wait time. Ready? Questions. Okay. Whew, thank you. Ah, I made it. Okay, so who has a question? And also the reminder that it is being captured on Zoom. So if you can get to a microphone so it can be captured for Zoom, that would be great. Tucker.
One of our Zoom attendees would like to ask if you'd be willing to provide a copy of your scavenger hunt that you use for your syllabus.
Sure. I'd be happy to provide it. If I can either take that email or give it to you, Tucker, and there's somewhere maybe you could post it. Sure. Cool. I'd be happy to. Yeah. Wait, David.
So you teach literature? You teach.
Yes.
So I was curious, you talked about thriller for musical chairs. Have you ever chosen music that is more centered to what they're reading, like 20s jazz for F. Scott Fitzgerald or Grapes of Wrath? You might use Woody Guthrie.
Oh, that's, I was just teaching a medical literature class and I used Sarah James' Pumping Blood. And it goes, this is your heart, it's alive, it's pumping blood. And it's really fun and bouncy. Thriller was just because it was Halloween that day. So it seemed fitting. But yeah, like to create a tie with the music that you use for something like that. I also really love capturing those minutes before class begins as some way to make those connections or get them thinking about class. So things that I have done, I've noticed that if I start every class with a question, they start talking about, if it's the same question every time, they'll start talking about it before I prompt them. So once in a graduate creative class, they had to learn a new hobby and fail at it. And so people would just talk about how they were failing before class began. But it was a great bonding moment. And they would all just jump in on talking about that before I began. They gave me that great idea with the pictures. So then the slides would just be up and they'd be like, oh my God, where is that? And they'd be like, oh, have you been to this, you know, the taco truck that's up the hill and whatever, you know, so that became a way that then they shared. In the medical literature class too, they were horrified that I'd never seen Grey's Anatomy. And so then I just like start with like, I just have a meme up of something of Grey's Anatomy and be like, okay, so I just watched the episode where, and then they would want to talk to me about it. So finding ways where it creates connection among them or connection between us, but some way to use that dead time before class begins where I'm like, you know, setting up the slides, hanging out, where it becomes a way where I can see them starting to connect more with each other, or I can check in with them and, you know, thanks for introducing me to Grey's Anatomy 15 years later or something. Here's what's going on in my life. But then that becomes like a nice way that we have a moment of connection and a chance to talk about something. So if you can find ways to use those are just a few examples of ways I've used that before class time. But music, I think, is a good one. Like, if you are somebody who loves music and just has songs on, then I think it will prompt them to ask you or be like, or you could just turn it off and be like, oh man, that was one of my favorites growing up. Or like, this is the one. For me, it's whatever song my kid is obsessed with. And then that becomes a way that you start connecting and making another connection with your students, just by greeting them with some, like, hopefully upbeat music. It doesn't have to be, but some sort of music when they walk in, and then they ask about that. What's going on there? Other questions?
How do you manage the time of all of these events to ensure you're getting the content that you wanna?
Yeah, I think in part with some of these, even like when to use it, we're somewhat similar. And so I think which activity is like, I just need to get them started, or which is one where we have a ton to review and this is the right activity. So it, and also it doesn't have to be every class period. There's lecture belongs in a class. Sometimes you need to be the one with the slide and the thing, and you're teaching them the thing. But just finding those times when, I often save it for later in the semester when they're flagging and they need a boost, when they need a way to like get up and move in the classroom, or something to shake up the usual flow of the class. But I think lecture is hugely important, and offering information in a certain way is very important, but then getting them to take those pieces that I've been giving them and start trying to fit them together. It also doesn't have to look like a game, but those just have been really ways that have been really good for me getting a certain level of engagement from students. So it doesn't have to look like that exactly, but I think another thing I have noticed is, as much as I want to give, there are mandated things you have to learn at certain stages of certain classes, but I always want to give my students everything I know every semester. They cannot use everything I know. They can't even take it in. So often, like, that's why I say repeat games too, is because I think I'm being repetitive because I'm listening very closely to my own monologues. But they need to hear it 2, 3, 4, 5 times. And then they're like, oh, somebody who took 4 classes with me said, you know, you've been saying that for years now. I just got it. And I was like, oh my God, 4 classes, but you're here. So I think sometimes I think I'm being boring or I'm going over something too much, but for people who are just learning it, which was part of the reason I did that exercise on learning a new craft and failing with my graduate level students, because I think we get really comfortable in what we know and we forget what it's like to learn. So I too try and take on a hobby almost every year so that I can experience sucking all over. But it teaches me about how I learn. It reminds me how hard it is to learn a new vocabulary of something. And like reminds me of like watching like YouTube videos on how to, you know, do this crochet pattern or whatever, teaches me like, okay, that's a really unique approach. I think what I'm gonna try and do is in class next is do this, because watching how I'm learning reminds me how hard it is to pick up something new. Especially first year classes, everything is new, right? Acronyms we're using for things, getting around campus, living in a new place, all that stuff is new for them. So trying to remember of like, making it as like bite-sized as I can, signaling very clearly why things are important, how to, you know, what study strategies are most successful for this style of class, things that you know so well already, you might forget that people don't know. So I try and think about like, what is it like to experience this for the first time, rather than I've been doing this for a long time. So that's one of the things that sort of helps me as a teacher, is to fail at stuff a lot. Just try something new, remember what it's like to suck at something rather than be the expert at it. And know that your students, many of your students, are experiencing your class that way and just trying but frustrated or whatever. I detoured there a bit, but hopefully that was useful. Maybe 2 more questions and then we can play some hot potato. No, I've resolved all your lingering questions about how to play games in class. So I think you all might have some of the best ideas for how to adapt games that you know super well, and how to take something that you love and bring it into the classroom and do something new with it. But we're gonna play Hot Potato, because my students introduced me to this idea. I have 2 stuffed animals with me here today, because Moose was not enough, so there's a capybara over there that will get started. Before we start moving, and this is key, every time you put people into groups or say, like, well, get into your usual groups or I'll number you off, they're going to start wanting to move their chairs. So you really have to make sure everybody knows what the rules are before anybody starts moving, because once they start moving, they're not paying as much attention. They're trying to get to the corner of the room. They're used to going for an activity. So check it out. Have people played hot potato before? Show of hands. Okay, we have a crowd that's very familiar with hot potato. This is great. Thankfully, Tucker has queued up the song Uptown Funk, which doesn't have a relationship to this talk today, just a song my son loves. So we're gonna, when I say go, we will rise and make a circle, which might mean that the back row could probably stay where they are and the front row can loop around. Nope, see? This is why you do things more than once, because practice. I think front row can stay where they are, and back row, you always try and hide in the back. This is where you'll come up over here and loop around to make a standing circle when we're ready, so that we can get the capybara and the moose going at different sides of the room. The music, I will tell you the question. The music will play and you will pass the moose and capybara. When the music stops, you must answer the question. Much like musical chairs, these are not questions that are meant to be like, you weren't paying close enough attention. You didn't take very good notes, did you? So they're just supposed to be fairly open questions. Some of them are review from things we talked about today. Some are just subjective, but that will let us practice something that also could be this is a very quick review one, right? If you can get everybody standing and tossing a stuffed animal around, then you can have the music stop. And especially if it's subjective or isn't outing somebody as like and making them feel that social anxiety being put on the spot, can be a fun way to do some sort of review or subjective question asking. So this is very similar to musical chairs, but has less. One of my rules for musical chairs is that, like, no pushing, no shoving, no biting, no KU-KSU basketball game shenanigans. We will be respectful to everybody. If you're left standing, it's a very easy question. But hopefully we won't have any of these issues with a very simple game of hot potato. So again, I'll say the question, the music will play. When the music stops, if you are holding either a reindeer named Moose or a capybara, you will have to be one of the two people that answers that question. Are there any lingering questions about how to play hot moose? Yes, Scott. I think you should just keep hanging out with us, and Tucker should do a good job watching when he hits pause the next time and make sure someone else in this very like large room full of people to give somebody else the wonderful opportunity to share one of their thoughts about today. Any other questions about rules? Make sure we all got it. Okay, how about back row, you're rising, front row, you're rising, but back row, you're the one that's moving to fill in this gap in our circle.
I think we could condense.
Yeah. So you even got the cheat sheet. You can even see my questions right there. Yeah.
What's his name? Captain?
Okay. All right, David, for your participation earlier today, you get to select who are you starting with. Okay. All right, you get the reindeer named Moose. I should have picked some Beyonce so that we could have known what direction, and then it could be to the left, everything you own in the box to the left. So you're always passing to the left with Beyonce in your mind, but Uptown Funk in your ears. Is that cool? Okay, so our first question, it's so easy, it's painful, because everybody paid such good attention to my nice monologue. And the first question is just name a game I talked about today. Oh, that's it? Can't even get a good shoulder shake to that. It's technically on, so you all can start passing. And Tucker gets to decide who gets stuck with these things, so. Is it that ice cold, Michelle? Oh, what's a game that we talked about already? Jeopardy, boom. Bingo, excellent. All right, nicely done. So Tucker, try and spare our two fine participants in the next round. Again, subjective question. What is a game you would consider playing in your class? Whether it is one I had named or one that you play that you think could work for your style of class. But what would be a good game that this semester you think you could try and incorporate in a discussion in your class. Brian, what would your call be if you were in a class that you think would be a game you would want to try and play with students? Yeah. Oh, one you could take to a meeting. I like that. Yeah. I know. Oh, nice. That's an excellent one. Truth or consequences. And what would you consider bringing into the classroom? Nice. Some cards against the humanities. Yeah, and in a game way, get them playing and invested. Excellent, cool. I still think getting some games into meetings is a good idea, but all right, this is more of a review question, but name a pro tip, either something I said or that you think is a good tip for if you're bringing a game into the classroom, what is a pro tip, something you should definitely do if you're incorporating a game. I named three, you can name one of my three or one that you think would be anytime you're doing a game, you should think about doing this or think about this. Got Chuck's on with Saint Laurent, gotta kiss myself, I'm so pretty. I'm too gonna police. All right, what's a pro tip that either I said or that you think, bringing a game in, this is what you gotta do?
Making sure everyone understands.
Boom, making sure everybody understands the rules. Nice, like connecting the concepts. This is the reason why we're doing this activity. Here's how it connects. Okay, our final round, our final question is just, I wanna hear other people's weakness or superpower. And you could say, I don't have a weakness, but yours is the teacher weight. If you don't wanna confess to your own weakness, but the last group left, I'd like to hear your teaching weakness or superpower, or both. Make a dragon wanna retire, man, I'm too hot. Say my name, you know who I am. All right, you've got the jingler. What is your superpower, weakness, one or the other?
Superpower for me.
Yeah. Flexibility. Nice. I like it. I feel that.
My superpower is making my students feel like they're listening.
Nice. That's a really great one. I'm sure students really appreciate that one too. All right, so this was, again, I have these stuffed animals just hanging out in my office. So if this feels like an easy one, everybody's energy is low, stand up, here it comes, here comes the moose, that like can get people just like, oh no, I better raise my hand or she's gonna bring out the moose. But this can be like a really easy way. You don't even have to buy any chocolate bars, right? I should have brought you guys something. For your students, but this is just one way to practice a very small activity that would be a fairly easy one to incorporate, that they're gonna remember, it was kind of silly. In this way with the stuffed animals, right? That one was my son's, I brought that one with me and I showed them my photos. When I was in college and studied abroad, I was alone and so I would take pictures with the stuffed animal. So then I got to show them something about my time in college and that this was something that we also had to take good care of because I've had it for a very long time. So it can be a way, whatever you use in the hot potato game can be something that then also shares something about you at like the level of my kid's into capybaras sort of thing, but like lets you share something about yourself in the classroom and helps make it memorable. Or if you just have an actual potato, that is also memorable. Thank you for coming to the talk. I hope people got something valuable out of it. And if you have any remaining questions you didn't want to ask into a microphone, I'll be hanging out for a few minutes and would be happy to be helpful. I'll also email that syllabus scavenger hunt. And if anything else, if I talked about any other games that you'd like to see lesson plans for, I'd be happy to share examples of some of the things that I've done in class. Thanks for coming. Thank you.